At 6:31, call ourselves to order. Now that our budget and finance people showed up. If you would rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Eva Henry, Steve Odorizio, Jeff Baker. Okay.
Jeff Baker here.
Elise Jones, David Beacom, Randy Wheelock, Sean Wood, Christy Panganello, Robin Kneach.
Here.
Roger Partridge.
Here.
Gail Watson.
Thanks, sir.
Zabo, Casey Tai, Bob Pfeiffer.
Here.
Bob Roth.
Here.
Larry Bittum. David Spellman, Aaron Brockett.
Here.
Ann Justin.
Here.
Lynn Baca, Rex Bell, Tara Radloff, Jeff Blue, George Teal.
Here.
Doris Chular.
Here.
Laura Crispin.
Here.
Richard Champion.
Here.
Rick Teeter. Rick Teeter.
Here.
Debbie Nasta, Catherine Whitman, Steve Conklin, Kara Swanson, Joe Jefferson,
here.
Jeff Deacon, Mark Gruber, Daniel Dick, Lisa Jones, Laura Brown, Lynette Kelsey,
here.
Scott Norquist, Storm Glore, Saoirse Karis Graves, Casey Brown, Ron Rakowski,
right.
Mike Hillman, Brad Weasley, Stephanie Walton, Shockey, Jerry Bean, Isaac Levy, Phil Cernanek.
Present.
Wynn Shaw.
Here.
Joan Peck.
Here.
Ashley Stolzman.
Here.
Connie Sullivan. Dan Greenberg. Colleen Whitlow.
Here.
Deborah Jerome. Sean Forey. Chris Larson. Kyle Mullica.
Here.
John Dyack.
Here.
Sally Daigle. Gary Howard. Rita Dozal.
Here.
Heidi Williams. Eric Montoya.
Here.
Herb Atchison.
Here.
Joyce J.
Here.
Adam Zarin.
Here.
Deborah Perkins-Smith.
Here.
Bill Van Meter.
Here.
And we do have a quorum.
How's it going?
Thank you very much. Can I have agenda item 4, a motion to approve the agenda? We have a motion and a second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? All right, agenda item 5, report of the chair. The first thing that we have is a 5-year service award to Ann Justin from the town of Bomar. So, Ann, if you could come down. Okay, next is a report on the RTC meeting, and actually we had a pretty healthy amount of action items, but they are all on the agenda tonight, with the exception of one, but I think it'll be on the agenda next time. So there's really nothing to report out on because we're going to hear all of the same presentations tonight. So report on P&E, Bob Pfeiffer.
Thank you, Chair. Just an update on our executive director recruitment. We have finalized the job description, and it has been sent out and posted. And so we are starting to see applications come in. And right now, I think it's open. Looking to my subcommittee chair, but I believe it's open for 3 weeks, but it's posted as until filled. So we'll keep you posted on that progress. Anything you'd like to add?
Interviews are scheduled for the short list, which we think could be anywhere from 5 to 8, somewhere in there. We'll see that as it comes about, on September 13th and 14th. The subcommittee will be, has already been contacted. I think I have 100% of the subcommittee that will be in attendance, so we'll start those, and then we'll move those up to the full P&E committee, then on up to the board.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Next is report on the finance and budget. Director Dyack.
Great. Thank you, Chair. We did a number of things right before the meeting here. Approved authorization for the executive director to accept approximately $132,500 in funding from the Colorado Department of Health Care Policy and Financing to continue providing services for the aging and disability resources for the Colorado program. We also approved authorization for the executive director to expand Dr. Cog's Colorado Choice Transition Program to include transition coordination services, estimated at $202,500 annually. We talked about the Dr. Cog audit. The 2016 audit was presented by our CPAs and found no findings were reported in this audit. Reported that it was a very clean audit, and thanked staff for that. We also talked about the continued search for office space for Dr. Cog due to anticipated growth in the organization. And on your workspaces, we have a draft copy of the two other alternate options that F&B is discussing. We're looking at 1290 Broadway, but we also have two different other buildings. It's 1225 17th Street and 1700 Lincoln Street. It's labeled draft because things are still getting finalized. I'm going to bring Sam up in a minute, but you know, things such as square footage haven't really been finaled. I think Sam reported to us we're about 90% of the way there. We're going to schedule some meetings, but I'd like to invite Sam up to kind of give us a brief report as to what we talked about.
Well, good evening, everybody. Just quick introduction. I'm Sam DePiesel. I'm an executive vice president with CBRE Office Leasing. Dr. Cog is my oldest client. I've represented you the past 18 years, and I've been in commercial real estate 20. So you can do the quick math on that, right? So they hired me right away, which was a mistake, but I've gotten better over the years. That's a joke, Doug. This is good. So I just wanted to bring the board quickly up to speed. Thank you, John, for that introduction on where we are in this process. We started it with evaluating an expansion and a renewal here at 1290 Broadway, primarily driven by the growth of AAA. We have, as you know, 3 years remaining on our primary lease term here at 1290 Broadway. And the market's in flux. You know that from looking out your window and seeing all the cranes. And 1290 Broadway changed their pricing structure and strategy with respect to this asset and effectively said no to what we thought was a very good proposal to take over the 14th floor and right-size our space within the building. So to put this in context, when we looked at the 14th floor here, it was the Sykes space, and actually did that deal for Sykes. And Sykes had, it's this two-year-old space, and it's beautiful. They had invested $80, $90 a foot, brand new furniture, sound masking, and really represented a material upgrade to what Dr. Cog has presently at 1290 Broadway. So with that said, we had the continued growth from AAA, which hasn't abated, which is going to continue, and we also had really planted this seed about how to help Dr. Cog, which historically has been capital constrained with respect to investing money in furniture, technology, et cetera, in conjunction with their leases, right? Because you get a tenant improvement allowance from the building, that's historically been it, with getting this all done in one fell swoop. So over the past 5 or 6 months, I've been meeting with finance and budget on a regular basis, and we've been giving them periodic updates on a monthly basis as to the progress we've been making. And we've been looking in the central business district in the periphery of downtown, something central, right, which can accommodate Dr. Cog and its needs moving forward. And at this point, we've identified two buildings, 1700 Lincoln and 1225 17th Street. And as John spoke about just moments ago, this transaction, as it stands today, is 90% complete. We don't have a final space plan, but we're close. We vetted the pricing. Both landlords are amenable to the overall structure, but the final terms haven't been fully vetted and finalized, so that's important. But the other thing that's super critical here is that if you look at the projected cost savings over our base case, which is a renewal here at 1290 Broadway, they're substantial. And as I started here earlier, I stated that we have 3 years of remaining lease term on our primary lease at 1290 Broadway, which has been the challenge, if you will, with the move or coming up with a scenario in which a move would be feasible. Because we can't be in a situation where DRCOG has any double rent, right? And we still have to get the tenant improvements needed to get the build out, get the new furniture and the technology in place, et cetera, and right-size DRCOG. So both of these options, 1700 and Lincoln and 1225, you'll see two scenarios. One is a best case, one is a worst case. The numbers that you have in front of them of you today on this sheet, 1700 Lincoln and 1225, and there's some additional stuff here which I'll talk about briefly, represent a scenario where we're not successful in subleasing 1290 Broadway. This deal had to stand on its own without any subleasing effort, a zero recovery on our remaining balance here, which it does. And then the second scenario represents a 50% recovery on the remaining term at 1290 Broadway, okay? And honestly, I hope to do better. You know, we're at a $28 roughly full service gross number. That means all in. So the sublease would be at $14 for full service gross, and there's nothing else downtown that on the periphery which even comes close. So, but again, that's, we modeled this very conservatively. Also, when we looked at modeling these numbers, we looked at a tenant improvement budget, which not only incorporated your initial build, but incorporated your furniture, $25 furniture allowance and technology and move costs. So another important point about this is that as modeled, that there's going to be zero to minimal upfront capital for DRCOG to execute a lease either at 1225 or 1700 Lincoln. That's the other big component to this. All right? So that's kind of the brief overview of where we are today. But kind of given where we are in this process, a lot's going to be happening in the next 30 to 45 days. So we wanted to make sure that with John's direction, this was on your radar screen.
Great.
At this point. So those are all open up to.
Yeah. Thanks, Sam. I appreciate that. Sam's been with DRCOG for, I think, 18 years, so he knows the organization very well. He's worked with staff. It sounds like it's been very a very good and robust conversation. We have three quality options, two outside of this office building. F&B really believe that even though it's our decision, we believe we need to communicate to the full board and provide some transparency. The draft page is a tribute to Vice Chair Stolzman, so if you like it, compliment her. If you don't like it, you can blame me. So, again, it's just if there are any questions, should we take questions, Executive Director?
Yeah, questions or comments.
Great.
Director Crispin.
And I know that you couldn't do all the apples and oranges, and it wasn't. But your base expenses, my experience with these two buildings is that 1700 Lincoln has a lot of common area, far more than 17th Street Plaza. And a common complaint of tenants over time was how much they were paying in their expenses, because they loaded the common area expenses for retail onto the office tenants. I don't know if they still do that, but that whole atrium is incredibly expensive to both heat and to air condition. 17th Street Plaza, on the other hand, has almost no common area other than the lobby and obviously the... So when you're doing your comparison, I would look at that, because it has been a big complaint for many of the tenants in this building. So that was it.
Okay, just to address that, Beacon, which owns 1700 Lincoln, the lease is done now on a, and I don't want to get too technical here, but on a net basis, which means that's exclusive of operating expenses, which we've modeled at the 2018 number, and we've grown at 3%. So the common area factor and the uniqueness to 1700 Lincoln, which comes in its large atrium, are included in this financial analysis. It's the way I would address that. But you're right, that is a unique characteristic to that building and something we're certainly cognizant of. On an additional note, we look at that large common area as a potential benefit to Dr. Cog because the building will let us use that for Dr. Cog functions. Right? Historically, we go to, you know, a hotel downtown and have our functions.
Like award celebration, stuff like that.
Yeah, so that we would have the ability to use that atrium for those events.
Director Cernanet.
Thank you, Sam. In both instances for the other buildings, it refers to covered secured parking, important for employees, but also we have events that, such as a board meeting that has other folks beyond the direct employees of the organization. What allowance is there or provision is there for those that in both of these instances?
Thank you for that question. Yeah, parking is a huge one. So a couple things here. These are AA buildings, okay? So this is an A asset, arguably a high B asset. It's a totally different class of building. And for those that come on the tour of both, you'll quickly see that. And with that, how these buildings get classified in that classification is just this. Covered parking, secure 24/7 security, restricted access, all of these things. It's an upgrade from where you are currently. So, and the second way I would address this is that I know parking is super critical to Dr. Cog from a board member, from a fleet perspective, from the committees that come in with visitor parking, right? That's mission critical. And the other thing that's mission critical is the conferencing component, right? So a logical question to me is how are we affording this? The reason is that here we pay rent on our conferencing space. That's incorporated into that rentable number that we pay rent on. All right, at both 1225 and 1700 Lincoln, we're taking out that conferencing from the rentable number because both buildings invested heavily into common area conferencing, and they're going to allow us to book our conferences, okay, ahead in perpetuity and configure those conferencing rooms. So we're taking that out of that rentable number, so that's why we're shrinking that number which we're paying on, and that's why these numbers work the way that they do. So that's the other big point I would make, but we are paying close attention to the parking and the conferencing.
Yeah.
Director Mullica.
Thank you, Chair. Can you just give me a total square footage? I just see here that 17th Street is 7,000 square feet larger than Lincoln. So can you give me a total square footage and then what's our total square footage here?
So right now we're 28,000 feet here, including the conferencing space, approximately. We're 24,000 feet approximately at 1700 Lincoln, and we're 30,000 feet approximately at 1225 17th Street. What the caveat I would make here is that 1700 Lincoln and 1225 are not completely finalized. And I'll start with 1700 Lincoln. As it stands today, we're able to get the entire Dr. Cog operation on one floor plate. Okay, they're bigger. It's 24,000 feet and it's a large rectangle at 1700 Lincoln, okay? And we're shrinking the cube sizes to 6x6. At 1225 17th Street, it's a rectangle, but it's a slightly smaller plate. It's 22,000 feet, and we're putting AAA onto a partial floor. And as it's currently configured, we're in about 30,000 feet. That's why those numbers that you're looking at, there's a variance, a pretty substantial one right now is presently modeled between the overall cost between 1700 Lincoln and 1225. It's our hope as we continue to drill down on this and vet that the 1225 floor plate, we're able to shrink that square footage number, but that's in process.
Yes,
Mr. Chairman, just to, a little more information on that, Director, that you know the 28,000 square feet that we currently have includes that conference space, so I hope that's not lost on everybody. So 7th floor is like 19, Roxy?
19,000.
About 19,000. We're on 7th floor.
Right.
Other questions or comments?
The other thing too, I put in here, just in general, this is from an employee standpoint a huge upgrade, because like we have new bike lockers, you know, which we're not talking about. Fitness centers, new, free of charge. So like when you go take a look at this is really a very employee centric, not just cost, right, in addition to the new furniture and the technology. And that's kind of the last note I would leave on that.
So if I,
okay, yes,
if I may, just real quick, just with regards to next steps, we talked in Finance and Budget Committee that we will be, the committee expressed a desire to tour both facilities, so we're going to set up a couple times for those tours. With the permission of the Finance and Budget Chair, I would open that up to anybody who would be interested in doing that. If you're so interested, please just let us know, and we'll make you aware of those dates when they're set. And after that, you know, we expect this to move, you know, fairly quickly and with the direction of Finance and Budget over the next 30 to 45 days, as Sam suggested. And it might require some additional Finance and Budget Committee meetings, but we hope to have a decision here, you know, within the relative short term.
Anything to add, Director Dyack?
No, I mean, again, I think all is welcome to the tours. So, you know, please feel free. Let us know. Again, it's a fast-moving process. It's a lot of information to digest. We've discussed it for a number of months, and hopefully we can come to a conclusion shortly.
Okay, I'll say one more thing, Mr. Chairman.
Third by
I know, I know. This is it. with regard, just to give you some concept of, you know, just to give you some concept of, you know, our need for space in the short term. We currently have really cubicle space for four people right now. We're expecting to add an additional 16 between now and the end of the year, all in AAA. So there's an immediate need, and we've had discussions about desk sharing and all that, and we'll make it work in the short term, but it's not something we can do for an extended period of time, certainly not 2.5-3 years of our current lease. Thank you, sir. I'm done.
I'm waiting. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. All right, he isn't done because now we have the report of the executive director.
And I got pages. No, first of all, welcome back. I missed y'all. I hope you enjoyed your hiatus away from 1290 Broadway, but we're glad you're all back. We got a good crowd this evening. First, I wanted to hit on the 2017 board workshop. It's currently scheduled for August 25th, 26th down in the Springs, Colorado Springs, that is. Hotel reservations must be made. Yes, we have a card on that. Hotel reservations must be made by July 25th. So please, please, you do it or have some of your staff do it or somebody do this. I'll do it for you. Just give me a call. But we want to get you all guys there. I think we got a pretty good agenda, and we're going to make it as interactive as possible and quite frankly, as fun as possible. So please do sign up for that. It's always a good event. You know, one of the things that directors, have always said they liked about that event is the opportunity to network with their fellow board directors and the like. And this also includes, learning about other communities. So there was a great suggestion made by a member of the P&E committee to ask if communities would like that they're going to be present at the board workshop, if they would create a poster that just talks about some of the great things that are going on in your community. Now, staff will be reaching out to you with some further information about that and what that poster might look like, the information that might be included on that. But we thought it was a great idea, and we would, once we get those, then we'll exhibit them around the main conference room. And so it's your opportunity to brag about your own communities and the reason why this region is as great as it is. Board collaboration assessment. The results and analysis of Dr. Carl Larson are included in your packet as attachment I is for your information. For those that filled out the survey a couple months ago, thank you very much for doing that. And for the new folks, that this really is your feedback mechanism to voice your opinions about your experience here at DRCOG. So we thank you all for doing that. I think Dr. Larson's analysis is very good and very in-depth, and we would like for you to review that at your leisure. Mobility choice update. I think the majority of you know that we're back on track now with the mobility choice blueprint. We kind of had a reboot. We finally got the final bit of funding for that project from RTD. And just as a refresher, DRCOG is partnering with CDOT, RTD, and the Denver Metro Chamber to create an environment that embraces advanced transportation technology to solve some of our mobility needs. And what the three public entities are doing, they're equally funding at $400,000. It was originally $500,000, but that has been reduced to $400,000 to create a blueprint. And basically that blueprint, or it's a study, will help us in preparing for this inevitable expansion of technology. How can we use that technology to our benefit to improve mobility and to, you know, make us as attractive as we can for economic development purposes and all that kind of good stuff. So I pointed out the funding amount because we have included the total funding package now in the Transportation Improvement Program, and we have an admin modification in your packet this evening as attachment I that if you're interested you can see it in there, but the full package now of the $1.2 million for that study is included in the TIP. On June 29th, Dr. Cog hosted a Small Communities Hot Topics Forum. The topics were intergovernmental collaboration and affordable housing. We had 23 participants from 13 communities that participated in that, and by all accounts, I believe that went over extremely well. I see some head nods, so I'm glad that's the case. I know there's a survey out there now, and I would encourage you to fill out that survey, so we're always looking for ways for new topics or to improve that. So please fill that out. But I want to thank Flo Rotano of her staff who spearheaded that effort. I think she does a tremendous job with our small communities, and we appreciate all that attended. Staff also participated in an after-action review of the I-25 tanker crash and fire, which occurred on May 31st near Orchard and I-25. Participants included State Patrol, CDOT, and South Metro Fire District, local governments, and other law enforcement and emergency response agencies. Participants discussed the strengths, weaknesses, and lessons learned from this successful response effort, and it really was. I think we're getting a lot of national attention by the amount of partnerships and efforts that went into that incident. Dr. Cog is also working very hard with the State Demographer's Office right now to develop a new regional employment forecast. Both the forecast helps both our land use model as well as our transportation modeling efforts, as well as a bunch of other initiatives here at Dr. Cog. The draft forecast and methodology have been reviewed by multiple independent economists throughout this region, and over the past few weeks, we've also been meeting with local government staff just to talk about that. You'll hear more about this at our September meeting, where our chief economist, Dan Jarrett, will be providing additional information on where we're going with that forecast. Let me see. Last but not least, at your March and May work sessions, you were provided with direction. You provided Dr. Cog's staff with direction on the region's shared growth management initiative. It was previously called the urban growth boundary area concept. We've kind of renamed that, and we actually had a virtual meeting webcast type thing with many of your staff. We had 15 local governments that were represented at that, just to kind of get the ball rolling, and we will be providing a lot more information to you all in the coming months. Looks like September, we will be providing a update to you all at the work session. With that, Mr. Chairman, that is my report.
Thank you very much. Questions or comments for Mr. Rex? Okay, moving on. Agenda item 7 is public comment. We allow up to 45 minutes allocation for public comment. Each speaker will be limited to 3 minutes. If there are additional requests above and beyond the 45 minutes, we will have time allocated at the end of the meeting to complete public comment. We do request there be no public comment on issues for which a prior public hearing has been held before this board. Our consent and action items will begin immediately after the last speaker. And I see we have our first speaker. Go ahead, sir.
My name is Randall Loeb. I live here in Denver, have for most of my life now. I'm about 67 years of age, congestive heart failure. Most of the time that I've been involved with this organization, and most of them throughout the metro region, it has been on extreme poverty. Extreme poverty in this case is where a person can stay. The right to rest has been promulgated by a group of people, but I'm not that crazy about it. I want disaster relief services like they've done in many cities. I want to make sure that people throughout the metro region, whether they be in rural areas or in the urban area, in the corridors, whether they be young or my age or older, are safe. The SPDAT, VI SPDAT, if you don't know what it is a crazy way that the federal government decided that they would basically screen out people who were most likely to die. I'm most likely to die, but they'd never give me a place to live if I didn't work for it. And it's hard for us as we age, and we've been homeless. I was chronically homeless for more than 15 years in the metro area, unfortunately. I have several levels of education, so that's the reason why I'm basically so accomplished at being able to talk to you. And I do it all the time with children and things. But I really feel we have to put our heads together and be creative about a disaster relief services, and we haven't done it. Even in the Denver area, the $150 million is only a drop in the bucket. I work with the Colorado Coalition for the Homeless. It costs us $40 million just to do the health care center that we have with three levels of housing. I do clerk work at night at Civic Center Apartments from 11 to 7, and the problems that people face are astronomical. So I mentioned to one of your people the area of trauma. We need to basically reconsider how it is that we address people who are suffering. And I'm one of them. I have bipolar disease, but so what? I still go on, and I still will to the last breath. But many of the people that I deal with all the time, they've given up. They don't have any place to go, and they need trauma care. And if you don't know what I mean when I say that, it's something for us to all explore. I'm a resource to you. I have been since the first day I talked to you, and I pray that I will be again able to address you and help you. And I'm really done with this, so please, thank you very much. I'm honored to be able to speak to you again.
Thank you, Mr. Loeb. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board this evening? Seeing nobody, we will move on to agenda item 8, consent agenda, which is basically under attachment A. It is the minutes from our last meeting. Any comments, corrections, changes? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion. We have a motion and a second. Discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Thank you very much. All right, agenda item 9, which is under attachment B, which is the discussion of amendments to the committee policy guidelines and descriptions. Mr. Rex.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff is recommending the removal of two committees from our committee guidelines. The first is the Fire Personnel Recruitment Advisory Committee, which was quite frankly disbanded in conjunction with Dr. Cog ending our firefighter interregional recruitment and employment program. And the second is the Steering Committee on Baghdad-Denver Regional Partnership. This committee has not met in a long, long time. Before Connie in her current role, so we are recommending that both of those be removed. Now, we're not suggesting that we remove or not continue with the Denver Baghdad partnership. It's just that steering committee doesn't appear to be needed.
Questions or comments? Director Cernanek and then Director Shaw.
Just a quick question relative to the Baghdad-Denver Regional Partnership. Hosting some of the events has been fascinating as we go through this. So this ends up being taken over as a staff activity?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Director Shaw.
I just have a question on page 3. There should be a strike through on two committees, not just one. Oh, you got that.
Very good catch. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? I'd entertain a motion. Have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. And abstentions. Thank you. All right, agenda item 10, which is under attachment C. Matthew Helfont is going to talk with us about the critical urban freight corridor.
Perfect. Good evening. Matthew Helfand, Senior Transportation Planner here at DRCOG. We have Jeff Sudemeyer here from CDOT to make a request to DRCOG to designate a critical urban freight corridor.
Thank you, Matthew. Good evening. Jeff Sudemeyer, CDOT Multimodal Planning Branch Manager. As Matthew mentioned, I'm here tonight requesting the designation of a critical urban freight corridor of the DRCOG board. This is a new process, a new designation created about a year and a half ago under the FAST Act. So I'd like to back up a little bit and provide you a little bit of context about the designation. And I'll begin by doing that by discussing the National Highway Freight Program, which is a federal funding program that's tied to the freight corridor designation. So the National Highway Freight Program is a new formula freight program created under the FAST Act. It provides approximately $15 million to Colorado annually beginning in federal fiscal year 16. This past winter and fall, we went through a process to identify projects for the first 2 years of funding. That process included a consultation through our Freight Advisory Council, our Statewide Transportation Advisory Committee, and through the MPOs and TPRs on priorities for freight and approach and criteria to the project selection process. We reviewed and evaluated and identified recommended projects that were brought before the Transportation Commission in May and approved for those first 2 years of funding. And that included 14 projects totaling approximately $35 million. So you can see on the slide, these are the 14 projects that were identified for funding in that initial round of the National Highway Freight Program. And it includes three projects in the DRCOG area. US 85, Luveers to Meadows, approximately $6 million in supplemental funding was provided for that reconstruction and widening project on US 85 in Douglas County. US 85 Vasquez, I-270, approximately $4 million was provided going towards pre-construction activities associated with the reconstruction of that interchange and improvements to the intersection at 60th Avenue. And finally, $1 million was allocated to the PEL that is soon to kick off on I-25 Central. And the focus there is really included in that PEL is two low vertical clearance bridges that are frequently hit by trucks. So getting back to the corridor designation, projects receiving funding through this program are required to be on the National Highway Freight Network. The National Highway Freight Network includes a couple of components. The primary highway freight system is sort of the base part of the network, and that is identified by the feds. And in Colorado, it primarily includes the interstates and some portions of some small corridor segments in the metro area. The FAST Act also provided states and MPOs with the opportunities to make some limited designations of additional corridor segments under what's called the Critical Rural and Urban Freight Corridor designation, where we were given criteria and mileage limits. And in Colorado, we're following a similar approach to other states, which is to, given the limited number of miles, to identify projects for funding and then make corridor designations based on those funding decisions. Again, limited number of miles. We can change those over time, so I anticipate we'll come back in the future, de-designate corridors, redesignate corridors as the need for investment shifts to different areas. So as I mentioned, if a project is not already on this base network, it needs to be designated part of the network. The three projects I mentioned, one of them, I-25 Central, is already part of that base network, so no action is needed. The US 85 project in Douglas County has already been designated a critical rural freight corridor by CDOT. The state DOT is responsible for designations outside of an urbanized area, and so that's why that corridor was actually designated by CDOT. The US 85 Vasquez corridor, however, is within the DRCOG urbanized area, and it's therefore the MPO's responsibility to make a designation. So the requested action is approval of the designation of Vasquez Boulevard from approximately 52nd Avenue to 64th Avenue as a critical urban freight corridor. And just to provide a little context on that request, you'll see general location on the left and a zoom in on the right. The corridor segment is about 2 miles, beginning a little bit to the south of 62nd Avenue and continuing north to 64th Avenue. And so that is generally the project limits with a little bit of buffer on either end. And so I'll close with just highlighting a couple of next steps. The process we just described was just for the first 2 years of funding, fiscal year 16 and 17. We minimally have an additional 3 years of funding under this program, potentially more. We're currently in the process of developing a new state freight plan, and that is going to be completed this fall. As part of that process, we're going back to the project selection process, revisiting criteria and establishing kind of the framework for where this program will go in the next few years. And so I anticipate that that we'll be coming back in the future with additional designations. Additionally, that process of identifying projects for those subsequent years of funding, we will come and discuss with TAC. There's opportunity to provide input through TAC, through STAC, our Freight Advisory Council, as well as with your CDOT region in terms of priorities and ideas for future years of funding.
And with that, there's a request on the table from CDOT to designate a critical urban freight corridor.
Director Rakowski.
Before, just a brief comment. This is a piece of legislation which is long overdue, and there's a piece of it that's actually, in my view, potentially life-saving, and that is the mobile port of entry teams will get support in terms of better pull-offs where they stop trucks and inspect them. And if you've ever stood on the edge of in the shoulder of an interstate highway, anywhere close is a dangerous thing. And when we go ahead and implement this legislation, it'll have a very positive effect on not only the Colorado State Patrol, but the truckers that are there too. So I think this is an excellent thing for us to support.
Director Teal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not really sure which of the two staff members would like to speak on the subject, but how was the site chosen? I mean, and if I could ask, I don't recall this being up on the last tip cycle. So how was it chosen? Why are we having this option presented to us?
So are you referring to the specific projects in terms of how those were selected?
Specifically the one we're being asked to designate as critical.
Sure. So the project actually, and I should have mentioned this, but all three of these projects are subject to the TIP amendment that I think is on the agenda next. So you will be asked at that point to approve a TIP amendment, which will add the funds for these projects. In terms of how the projects were identified, again, we went through a process over the fall and winter of establishing criteria with our partners based on the federal program, and worked with the CDOT regions to identify projects that met that criteria, went through an evaluation process and a significant amount of vetting, primarily with our Statewide Transportation Advisory Council and our Freight Advisory Council, and identified the recommended set of projects that are before you today.
So just to ball that all up, I mean, this has been on the transportation improvement program for Dr. Cog.
And actually, I think all three of these projects are projects that previously existed in your transportation improvement program. And actually, what we're doing is adding additional supplemental freight funding to these projects. So these are actually existing TIP projects that had some amount of funding, not complete funding, but the freight funds are actually in all three cases adding to the funding package.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Director Teeter, I would ask, since this is in your municipality, if there's anything you wanted to add?
Yes, I Carmen City would welcome this. It's long overdue as far as we're concerned, and we're happy to see it.
Director Stolzman.
I'd like to make a motion if it's appropriate.
Go ahead.
I make a motion to designate US 85 Vasquez Boulevard from milepost 291.6 to milepost 293.8 as a critical urban freight corridor.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Director Partridge.
Certainly, I commend CDOT, the amount of work they've done on this, because it's really a heavy lift, no doubt. They've been working this for a long time. This section in Douglas County, we fully support. And I know the Transportation Commission has taken up and supported, as you mentioned, freight monies going to this area. And I'll let you know, we have on our agenda next week for the Board of County Commissioners in Douglas County to move $1.5 million to support what CDOT is proposing for this too. So we fully support this. I think it's great and for all areas around the metro area. I think again, commend CDOT for the great heavy lift they've done on this. So fully support it.
Further discussion? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions. Thank you very much.
Appreciate Thank you. It.
Next agenda item is 11, which is under attachment D. We're going to be talking about the amendments to the 2018-2021 TIP. And Todd Cottrell, please.
Thank you and good evening. So before you are 10 total amendments for the 18-21 Transportation Improvement Program. So the first three that are listed on the first page are relatively general standalone amendments. And these include the Region 4 Hazard Elimination Pool, where Region 4 is requesting to add an additional $7 million in funding. The second Broadway reconstruction project, this is a City of Boulder project that was selected with TIP funds. And this is part of the CDOT defederalization pilot program, and where they would replace all of the STP Metro funding with state ramp funding. The third is a Region 1 ADA projects, and this amendment is to adjust and add funding based on the latest funding estimates. The next two amendments react to the second commitment in principle to fast tracks that this board made back in July of 2008. This second commitment in principle, or SCIP, to the fast tracks corridors allocated specific dollar amounts to all of the corridors at that time. So back in early last month, the Southeast Corridor Partners approached Dr. Cog with a request for their full distribution of their $1.928 million of this federal funding. And according to the letter contained within Attachment 2, this would be going towards the base project of the Southeast Corridor. So the two amendments that are associated with action are on the top of page 2. And this simply removes the funding from the Dr. Cog pool and transfers it into the Southeast Corridor Extension Project. The remaining five amendments on page 2 deal with the National Highway Freight Program, which was the item that was just last discussed. There is three new projects in which freight funding is being added. These include the US 85 Cook Ranch to Meadows Parkway widening. As was previously mentioned, this is an existing TIP project. And it's with the freight funding is being added to this project, and then RPP is also being transferred from the Region 1 RPP pool. The second is the I-25 Central PEL. This is an existing project that's contained within the Region 1 RPP pool. This amendment would pull that I-25 Central PEL out of that pool, transfer it to be its own individually depicted project, and then the freight funding would be added. Very similar to that last project, the US 85 Vasquez project is an existing project contained within the Region 1 design program. That project would become a standalone project and the freight funding would be added. The remaining two amendments have actions associated with them to remove funding from those pools and transfer them to individual projects. So both TAC and RTC recommended these amendments before you, and I'd be happy to take any comments or questions that you may have.
Comments or questions? Seeing none, I'd entertain a motion.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Agenda item 12 is under attachment E, and this is discussion of project selection for the RTO, and we will hear from Mr. McKinnon.
Good evening. Thank you.
The discussion here will be looking at seeking approval for the recommended project allocations. Some background on the program: the Regional Transportation Operations RTO Improvement Program is a combination of two previous programs in the TIP, which was the Traffic Signal System Improvement Program and the Intelligent Transportation Systems Deployment Program. The purpose of the program is to invest in infrastructure and services to improve the capability of our regional partners to provide better day-to-day transportation operations. The focus is to look at things on a regional scale and not worry so much about the boundaries between different jurisdictions and modes. The program has and will continue to provide direct signal timing support services. We have staff here to be able to help the staff from your jurisdictions to improve signal timing in the region. We have a working group that's comprised of the operators, engineering and planning staff, and practitioners, and other stakeholders that assist in the planning and programming for this program. And in fact, over the years, about 30 jurisdictions and partner agencies have received funding or services through the program. As a quick summary of the project selection process, we had come to the board some time back going through the selection process. These are this is the goal and the program objectives. And essentially, we're looking to promote travel time reliability for all trips across the region. And we had a priority order of objectives that are trying to meet, and that's how we initially scored the applications that were submitted, and then came together with the stakeholders and project sponsors to review and establish the program. So quickly, the program summary that I have here: we received 29 applications. 22 of them are being recommended. Through the process, we had asked for project clarifications on the applications. There were some revisions to the engineer's estimates that the project sponsors resubmitted. Two projects were withdrawn. Two pairs of projects were combined into multi-year, multi-phase projects. And in the end, two projects were not recommended for funding, and one was recategorized as a support project, something that would be provided for the benefit of other projects in the program. So the in the motion itself is the summary or the allocations over the next 4 years, FY18 through FY21, and that is my summary report.
So I'll point out at the RTC meeting yesterday morning, the information on the projects was there, but the dollar amounts was not, and that was a question I asked. But as Mr. McKinnon just pointed out, under in the pink sheets, under the actual resolution, the dollar amounts are there if anybody's interested in seeing those specifically. Questions or comments?
No,
Director Frangadala.
Thanks. I just wanted to speak in support of this program as a whole. I think it's a place where our technical folks and all of our staffs and jurisdictions are able to work together really well to think about transportation from that, not only our jurisdictional perspective, but also what's happening in the region, and not only improve travel times, but think about from a safety perspective and also from a smart city perspective. This is a place where we have a lot of opportunity and great collaboration in the region to date, and an opportunity to shine in the future, to start thinking about how do we use this technology differently, to provide more information back to users, the customers that are out traveling, the traveling public. It's an area that we are super excited about and certainly support and appreciate the relationships and the participation and camaraderie with our colleagues and Dr. Cog.
So Mr. Rex and then Director Pfeiffer.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And wow, thank you, Director Fanganello. That was fantastic. I can't state it any better than that. I am going to regurgitate what I said a little bit at RTC yesterday. This is the most regional project that nobody talks about. It truly is. And I don't know if it has to do primarily with the fact we're talking about a bunch of modest engineers or whatever the reason. But, this is truly, a multi-jurisdictional collaborative effort. And I think a lot more attention will be placed on programs like this as we go forth, as Director Fanganello had mentioned. Because, as you know, Joe Jane citizen, they don't care what jurisdiction they're in. They just want to get from point A to point B as quickly as they can. And it's through programs like this, Dr. Cog, we're working individually with your local staff that makes some of this stuff happen. So I appreciate the comments of Director Fanganello, the staff at Dr. Cog, and all your staffs and your engineering staff. Do the line work.
Director Pfeiffer.
I don't know if I can add to any of the previous speakers, but I agree, it's regional as well as leveraging technology and advancements, because we can't always create roads, and this is a great opportunity where we can maximize our multi-billion dollar asset by looking at it a little bit differently than we normally do, and working more regionally and bringing technology to the table to help us work smarter, not harder. So again, I can't add more than that, but thank you very much, and I will be supporting it as well.
A tech guy.
Well, of course. I'm sitting by George Steele, too, so anything dealing with technology, as soon as those autonomous vehicles get here, I'll be really excited.
Other questions or comments? I would entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, move to adopt a resolution approving the project funding selections for the RTO improvement program.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions. Thank you, Mr. McKinnon.
Thank you.
Next item is agenda item 13, which is under attachment F, and this is discussion of adoption of the 2018-2019 Unified Planning Work Program. I will point out that we do have hard copies of the information. If you'd like one, you can also access it electronically on Dr. Cog's website, and I'll turn it over to Mr. Rex.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and as the Chairman mentioned, you have for your consideration this evening the FY 2018-2019 Unified Planning Work Program for our MPO area. This is a federal requirement that we produce this document every couple years, and it really does highlight the work that your Dr. Cog staff, as well as our partners and stakeholders, will perform using federal money over the next couple of years. I would like to just real quickly through the document note some sections within here. First, on page 3, we address how the UPWP addresses the federal planning factors. There's 10 planning factors, and what we have done is illustrate how we are planning to address those factors with the tasks and activities within the document. Then on page 9, we talk about the accomplishments over the last 2 years, or our current work program. We are very proud of the amount of work we've done. Most notably, of course, is Metro Vision and the Metro Vision Regional Transportation Plan that were approved here earlier this year. Thank you all for that. That looks good on the list of accomplishments, don't mind telling you. Then on page 14, this is really the meat and potatoes of the new UPWP, is the planning activities over the next 2 years. And some notable things is we will be implementing a new public participation plan, which is in construct right now. And we expect that program to be more robust than anything we've ever had here at Dr. Cog. So we're very excited about that. Now that we have a Metro Vision plan, we will concentrate on the implementation of that plan and working with you all in your communities to implement strategies that are fitting of your community that helps us get to the targets and outcomes that we desired within that plan. We also are planning to produce a freight and good movements report, and this will really piggyback on the work that CDOT's doing. And that was alluded to earlier in Jeff Sidmeier's presentation. So look to that here in the near future. We also, there's this little thing called the TIP that we will be working on over the next couple of years. We're already deep into that, and we'll be bringing some additional stuff to you all at your work session in August. We also are planning on initiating a regional Vision Zero strategy. And this really was born out of the Regional Transportation Committee several months ago, when we provided to them some information on, we do this annual, every so many years we do a crash report. and it was very disturbing, quite frankly, some of the stats that were included in that. And we felt it necessary, I say we, the RTC felt it necessary, that we take a further step forward and work at a more regional level on a Vision Zero platform. And there's also some additional stuff in there, of course, with regards to we're looking at getting more involved in incident management here at the regional level with DRCOG, and working with CDOT in accomplishing what we can at the regional level, as well as continuous improvements to our land use and transportation modeling and all that kind of good stuff. So last but not least, the last section I should probably point out is on page 40 is the UPWP financials, and those are an estimate of how our federal transportation dollars that we have for administrative purposes will be allocated to the activities and tasks over the next 2 years. We update this periodically over the 2 years, but this, as you know, is just an estimate right now, but it's useful.
Director Cernanek.
Thank you, Doug. Question is, with regard to TIP activity and system-wide principles, I think that would be important to highlight, and maybe it's in here somewhere buried.
Sure is.
Okay, so could you point that out for all of us so that we know that it is something that is part of our plan?
Yes, it is. It's actually federally required to be part of our Unified Planning Work Program and our activities going forth, but we will be placing a lot more emphasis on performance management of our work program, right? So with regards to our transportation improvement program, for example, will require to meet certain standards with regards to emission reductions and all that kind of good stuff. We also will have safety goals associated with the work that we do here at DRCOG, and you will be hearing a presentation about that in September, probably. I'm looking at Jacob, but I think it's September. And stuff like that. So yes, that is baked within the document, and it's a brave new world out there in the planning area, and it's all directed towards performance management.
Director Fanganello.
Two things. I noticed that I lost my note. We had an ITS regional plan that was last updated in 2010, and it looks like there are some other ITS related things in the work program right now, because 2010 seems like an awfully long time ago from a technology standpoint. So I just want to make sure we're thinking about that from a comprehensive perspective, particularly given what we just talked about and approved. And the second one, I just want to kudos to everyone for thinking about the Regional Vision Zero plan. If you're not paying attention to Denver, Mayor Hancock announced in February of 2016 that we're at Vision Zero City. And we are about to release our plan, a draft action plan, tomorrow for the community. So it might be something that we as a region or other communities might be willing or interested in looking at to see the types of things we're trying to address. And I would agree with you, Doug, what you're seeing in terms of serious bodily injuries and deaths in the Denver region is not good.
Well, I just might address the ITS one, and yes, we are. We are actually in the process right now of beginning to update our ITS, our regional ITS architecture. There are new standards to the genius of FHWA decided to change the way we do that, so there's a bit of a learning curve, but we're working on that right now, so we're on the same page.
Other questions or comments? Seeing none, I'd entertain a motion. We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Director Atchison? No? Okay. All right, seeing none, all those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. And abstentions. Thank you. So that is the completion of our action agenda. Next, we have informational briefings, starting with agenda item 14, which is attachment G. We'll hear from Ms. Stragand.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Hi, I'm Celeste Davis-Dragan, and I'm the Regional TDM Program and Marketing Manager for DRCOG. So thank you for having me here tonight. We had just a small event that happens to be the nation's second largest 3 weeks ago called Bike to Work Day. Did anybody in this room hear about that? Yeah? Awesome. Did anybody know somebody who participated in that? Awesome. Now, with those raised hands, how many of you participated in that? Outstanding. And those who haven't, I have an opportunity for next year. I will get you. It will happen. I'm just going to give you a brief overview of Bike to Work Day 2017, kind of talk about some long-term benefits to the region, and then where we go from here. So the Way to Go partnership established itself about 30 years ago, and we were funded through CMAC grants. And essentially, Bike to Work Day was created to create that kind of foyer into cycling. Like, let me try it for that first time, and let me see if this is something that maybe I could add into my commute choice options. And so that's why kind of we do Bike to Work Day and kind of where it came from. This year, we had over 34,000 riders. 37% were first-timers. That's more than 12,000 people out there cycling for the first time. And they were cycling about 9 miles each way. We traveled about four times around the earth. So 610,000 miles were traveled on that one day by bicycle, which is pretty exciting. And we engaged over 700 businesses and organizations in our business challenge. So we're really pleased with the efforts and results this year, and look forward to going for number one. San Francisco's got about 100,000 riders, so we have a little bit of a growth that we need to achieve, but I'm confident we're going to get there. If you're interested in seeing where are these people coming from? Where are they going? On our Way to Go website, waytogo.org, you can find this really cool interactive map that will show you destination and origin by cyclists on the day of that our friends within the RPD department put together. So thank you, RPD. I'm going to go over just a few highlights for 2017. We had some excitements this year with respect to sponsorships and prizes. We were actually able to raise over $46,000. And Steve, that was the largest in your term here, right? Highest number so far? Yeah. Awesome. We're really happy about that. And we had a really good PR experience with Biker and Wheelie. Biker and Wheelie were commute superheroes that allowed us the opportunity through these sponsorships to actually identify folks within the community and give them bicycles so they could have some reliable transportation. And we were able to partner with the Elder Refugee Program in AAA and actually identify a person in need. So that was really exciting, kind of marrying our two different groups to highlight some commute choices and options. And then we also identified active bike corridors within the region. We had five bike corridors coming from north, south, east, and west, and we kind of showed people how to get from where they lived into the Civic Center downtown area. And so one of those kind of super successes was Lakewood. We partnered with the Lakewood Bicycle Advisory Team, and they identified Addenbrook Park as a new station area, got a number of businesses to participate, and they had about 79 riders come through. Their goal was 30, I think. So we were really pleased with that kind of result and activation. Long-term, you know, Bike to Work Day is really Bike Today for a Better Tomorrow. It is a signature event that we do to really kind of establish ourselves as that healthy ecosystem within the region, and it's one of many commute choices. And you might say, well, why cycling? Well, between 2000 and 2014, the nation saw bike commuters double, and Colorado stands as number three within the nation for bike commuting. And we anticipate that to increase by 56% by 2040. So people are out there on two wheels, and they're excited about it. And they're excited about the 2,300 miles of bicycle facilities that we have in the region. And in our TIP, we've actually seen 21.4% of that last TIP cycle funding go towards bike and pedestrian projects. So we're really excited to see how registrations and Bike to Work Day really kind of lay that foundation and support for increased bike infrastructure within the community. So here's just a couple snapshots. You might see yourself, you might not. I know we had a party pick of Doug in there, which was really nice. Thank you for participating.
He needs to get his knees out more.
I'm not sure about that. Any questions? I know, Storm, you were an active participant in Bike to Work Day. You said you had a lot of fun. Does anybody have any questions for us about it? Ready to participate next year?
So I wanted to mention one thing that was in the slides, but it was on two different slides, so you might not have noticed it. But out of the 34,000 participants, almost 21,000 of them went to the website and registered their travel. So it was kind of cool that high of a percentage actually went to the DRCOG website and registered what their travel was. Mr. Rex, did you have something?
I did.
Other than bragging about the picture?
Well, I mean, you know, it's a good-looking dude up there. I a couple things. Well, first of all, you know, this was Celeste's first bike to work day, and this young lady, she hit it out of the park. I mean, I don't mind telling you, she did a fantastic job, and I think she. Well, I was just going to say, I think she would be the first to say that she would suggest that the entire communications team. Way to go team, as well as really, you know, our accounting and finance staff too, really helped at least internally in organizing some of the stuff that it went over really well. This whole biker and wheelie superhero thing kind of creeped me out, I don't mind telling you. But the one slide that showed, you know, where they're coming from and where they're to, there was one from Castle Pines to downtown. This guy right here. But it is pretty impressive. I mean, it's pretty robust, and you know, it shows geographic spatially how that all works, and it was pretty, there's a lot of equity, you know, around the region. Thank you.
Questions or comments?
Thank you.
Seeing none, that was an informational item, so thank you very much, Celeste. Agenda item 15 is committee reports. So we'll start with the stack, Elise.
Oh, Elise has left, and she asked me to report on the stack. Stack met, what, a week and a half ago, I think it was. Certainly a discussion on 267 from CDOT staff. I don't think we really have to go into it much, but it's certainly going to be a challenge for CDOT with the $50 million in payments that they're going to come up with. I know they're being very creative and looking at a lot of possible opportunities they can come up with that. So 267, he definitely has his challenge. You know, I think we're all kind of waiting to see if there's going to be a special session on that because of some of the lack of funding that was identified in that. But so far, nothing. We also had a presentation from CDOT on the Road X, an update on that. Things continue to go well, and to see how technology is going to bring about better transportation processes all the way around. And Panasonic has partnered with CDOT in Denver, and Peña Station Next has been a focal area. Also, presentation on the road usage charge, which is CDOT's look at the vehicle miles traveled. With the 100 volunteers they had, all of them said, hey, it was really a pretty good experience, pretty low maintenance, and there were three ways to report, from full GPS to self-reporting. So good response to that, and probably so that is to look at a replacement for the state, the 22-cent state gas tax that CDOT is running as a pilot program. That was it.
So I was at the AGC, Associated General Contractors, breakfast with the board this morning, and the Peña Station Next was one of the primary presentation items that we had. If you haven't seen that and you have an opportunity to see it, it is really well worth the time. It is a very exciting project, and the things that they're doing out there and the things that they're planning are pretty transformative. So if you have a chance to sit in on that presentation sometime, I'd highly encourage you to do so. Next, we have Metro Mayor's Caucus, Mayor Atchison.
Thank you. The Transportation Committee for the Metro Mayor's met this week, and we will be discussing with the full caucus at the next meeting the lack of transportation funding. Can't believe it, that's still an issue. But based upon the failure again this year of the legislature to get anything passed that would allow the public to engage in transportation funding through a referred measure, CCA also had to withdraw the five bills that they had planned based upon what was ended up being put in Senate Bill 267. And 267 hasn't, unless Deborah's got something new on me, hasn't been a real boom for them for funding. The potential of funding being redirected within the money that they are being authorized through the general fund changes is very high, has a very high probability if there are shortfalls in other areas. We also had a long discussion with Denver over the bonds that they're going. Originally, when this came out with the mayor's state of the city, there was some concern that this was the start of an RTA. Let me clarify real clear. What they are doing is bonding. It is not a tax increase. Robin, if you or Missy have got something different, This was a misperception that got started. This is not a start of an RTA by Denver. But I will tell you that Metro Mayors will be discussing at the next group looking at the formation of multiple RTAs in order to try to get something done with transportation. And from the county perspective, the municipalities will have to partner with the counties if they are going to form an RTA. We have looked at the legal requirements for RTAs and also looked at the legal requirements of modifying existing RTA law. It would even require the buy-in of all of the existing six RTAs around the state to change the law. That is not the current intent of Metro Mayors. We are trying to find some way to find funding in the metro area if we can't get it done statewide without the support of the legislation. We can't continue to do nothing, and that's exactly what has happened. And I'll remind you, 1242 was one vote short of being able to get to the people to let them voice their opinion. We will continue to bring that up. I anticipate that there will be representation from the Transportation Committee meeting with CCI in the near future to let them know what the Metro Mayors are thinking of. But keep in touch with the elected bodies you have, because, boys and girls, if we don't fix it ourselves from the local levels, the state's not going to do it for us, and the federal government is certainly not going to do it for us.
Thank you, Director Atchison. Metro Area County Commissioners, Director Partridge.
The report, we meet six times a year, so we took the summer off.
Very good. The Advisory Committee on Aging, Director Cernanek.
Yes, there was a meeting on June 16th. Some of the items that you may have heard in the earlier agenda, particularly with regard to space for the AAA, is in part due to the Finance Committee accepting the grant money, which leads to the staff additions in that regard. A couple of other things that we've been doing, and it's mostly Jayla in what she's been doing, which is orientation for new members to the Advisory Committee on Aging. We do have two members from each county, so as those turn over, particularly that does happen. And there is an audit relative to HIPAA. I think anyone that's associated with insurance, either being an applicant at some point in time or being visiting a doctor's office, you understand your HIPAA release that's there. As we deal with health information through the AAA, there is an audit that occurs. And one of the things that we've mentioned before relative to grant applications and grant receive is the fact that the Denver Metro Area Agency on Aging has been working really hard to diversify funding sources, and thanks to Jayla and her staff in that regard in bringing funds so it's not just for seniors but broadening it to veterans across age groups, so it's not just in the senior area. And also sharing some of the challenges and opportunities that exist with what is our naturally aging population, of which everyone is that in the room. If you're older today than you were yesterday, raise your hand. Okay, thank you on that. And so that's it for this time. And we will not have a report next month as we do not meet in July.
Thank you very much. RAC. Director Shakti.
The last meeting was in early June, and most of the items were informational. And I can't remember it terribly well, so if anyone wants to chime in, they're welcome to.
All right. E-470, Director Rakowski.
I was unable to attend. However, Director Shaw was there and will give us a report in a little.
Thank you, Director Shaw.
Thank you. The board approved a multi-year supplier contract for those little transponders. They actually impressed me with the pricing that they'd negotiated. There was another toll authority that really should get someone who can negotiate, one that they showed as comparative. So very pleased with what they did. We got a report from the marketing and communications people. They're tracking the advertising that's going on with source codes, from the media that you listen to when you apply for a new account with E-470. Your name goes into a drawing, so they're tracking these new enrollees, both in the short term for the revenue that they generate on the toll road and also over the long term. So the marketing programs have been very effective, and from a cost perspective are cash positive. So they're going to keep those up. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Fast Tracks Director Van Meter.
Thank you, Chair. Last month, the RTD board took a number of actions, none of them all that directly related to Fast Tracks, but a few items of interest for the group that I'll touch upon quickly. One, they awarded a contract to Parsons Transportation Group to proceed with the State Highway 119 Bus Rapid Transit Corridor Study. That's a NEPA, National Environmental Policy Act, and preliminary engineering study on the diagonal between Longmont and Boulder, looking at bus rapid transit. So the board approved that in June. Earlier this month, the board heard updates on RTD's past program working group and past program study. RTD's convened about 24, 25 stakeholders from throughout the district, including Executive Director Rex, and a diverse set of stakeholders who are meeting on a monthly basis to delve into the finances, equity, access, and a number of interrelated issues around RTD's past programs. That study is progressing, and the work of that working group continues, and we expect recommendations from that working group to RTD staff and the board of directors early next year. Two more quick items for me to brief you about. One, 16th Street Mall, City and County of Denver, in partnership with the Downtown Denver Partnership and RTD, have embarked on a National Environmental Policy Act NEPA study looking at the 16th Street Mall and how to make improvements. It's gotten a fair amount of press. We're actively involved in that and appreciate Denver's leadership on that. Finally, the strategic budget plan and annual program evaluations. Those are RTD's six-year budget plans adopted on an annual basis, are in the process of being developed right now. Our board heard a briefing on that last night. The strategic budget plan is a six-year plan for RTD's base system, supported by the 0.6% sales tax. And the annual program evaluation is the 0.4% sales tax allocation and Fast Tracks financial plans. They are both scheduled for further review. They both have gaps in financing right now that need to be closed. The board was updated about that last night, and action on those is scheduled for September. That concludes my report.
Thank you very much. So agenda items 16 through 19 are informational items. There's typically no presentation on those items. I will point out under attachment H, there is a draft agenda for the board workshop. I would really encourage you to attend the board workshop. Mr. X mentioned earlier that people comment all the time about the social time and the opportunity to interact with people from other municipalities and counties, and it really is very valuable. I did ask Mr. X how come the chair's remarks are limited to 15 minutes, but then I see that it's right before the social time, so I'll probably keep it to 5 minutes. The next item is our next meeting is August 16th. And then I will entertain any other matters for the good of the cause by members. Director Pfeiffer.
Well, I just want to point out that Channel 9 News corrected, if we all know how to say West Minister. Did anyone see that?
It's been about 10 minutes, him explaining how to say Westminster versus Westminster, or versa.
Arvada still can't get it right.
You're a suburb to us.
So. Okay, on that note, at 7:56, we are adjourned.